Hi, I'm Patrick McFadden, and let's talk about partitions. This is the most important part of a Cassandra data model. So pay attention. If you're gonna fall asleep, this is not the place to fall asleep. And I'm gonna make sure that you get this because this will make or break your life with a Cassandra data model. Did I overstate that? I didn't think so. So let's start with something a little easy here. I don't wanna overwhelm you with some freakiness. Here's a table. The table is just like what you would expect in a relational database, where you have a name of the table, some columns, and those fields translate into columns such as a user ID or a state. Now, this looks really simple, right? We have a primary key, which is pretty much the same in the world. It's pretty similar in that it shows that this is a unique record, but there's a little something different to this. When we insert data into the table, we have an insert, values, etc. All of that looks pretty familiar, but in this case, that data model underneath is really relying on the primary key. As we insert more data, you can see that it's very tabular. So whenever you query that data, it looks just like what you would expect when you're writing your application with a relational database. So as we're inserting a lot of data into the table, from an application standpoint, it looks exactly the same. So when you do a select, you get a table of data with rows and columns. Very familiar. Feels good, right? But what if we want to do something a little differently? Now, in this case, with the Cassandra data model, we're optimizing for the application. And in this use case, maybe we want to do some things with the data model to optimize for a few things. For instance, if we want to optimize for a particular location, what if we wanted to optimize by state, for instance? Now, this would mean that we would have to do in a relational database a group by statement. And that group by statement is very query dependent and relies on the node or the server to come up with all the actions that need to happen. Those can be a little costly. That's where you get into things like a full table scan, et cetera. That's not the fastest way to get to your data. In Cassandra, there's a big difference. Now with Cassandra, we have this idea of a partition key also being a part of how we group our data together. In this case, we're saying that the state field is how we want to group our data. So if we look at each one of these partitions, they each have a unique state. But that means we have to change our data model to take advantage of that. And this is where we think about our application. Our query needs to have the state as the logical grouping for this data. That's how our application works. But it also gives us a leg up in how the efficiency of the ring works. Now we talked about how the ring and the partitions really play together. This is an important concept. The partition key is how the data is placed on the ring. Let that sink in for a second. The choices you make in your data model can really make a huge difference in the efficiency of how you query your data. So when the data goes into the system, when you're inserting records in, that data is partitioned. It's using a consistent hashing algorithm, and it turns that partition key into that hashed number. And that hashed number is used later to place that data correctly on the ring. Now, that's not something you probably thought a whole lot about in the past. Like when I write a data model, I'm thinking about the physical layout of my data. And you shouldn't really get into it that deeply, but if you think about what the ramifications are, you're really pre-optimizing your data set, doing something like a materialized view in that query. So you're saying, I have a specific need for my data, I'm gonna optimize my data model, and knowing that it has something to do with the physical data model as well. So in the case where we have multiple partitions, and in this case, we have partitions based on state, we're gonna have to make sure we make the primary key say state. Now, when we say primary key state, we're saying two things. We're saying that the state is the unique part of the record and that this is how we're gonna partition it. The first value in a primary key is always the partition key. And that partition key, in this case being state, is not unique enough. What we're gonna have to do in real life is actually add one more thing to the primary key to make sure we're not overwriting records. If I had made state the only primary key, every time you insert a record, it would just keep writing over and over and over again. And that's not very efficient unless you wanted to store about 50 records in your database. Now, in this case, we have ID, which is a good enough thing to have in your data model to make it unique. Now, that is what we call a clustering column, and we will get to that later. The state here, though, is the partition key. And that partition key is still super important for where your data is in the ring. When we get to the point of the ring itself, that partition key can be translated really interestingly into where that data it resides on your ring. And that is a really cool concept about Cassandra. It's actually the secret sauce, if you ask me, because whenever I put data into the ring, I know where it's gonna go. So if you have a 1,000 node ring and you're inserting data for Texas, you know where it's gonna be. And that's a really interesting way to query your data as well. Since the partitioner is using a consistent hashing algorithm, that means that whenever you query your data is in the same spot. You don't have to go looking for it. And it's really quick. This is a constant time algorithm, order one for the computer scientist out there. That means that whenever I say, go find Texas, I know exactly where it is in that 1,000 node ring. And that is the secret sauce, and this is why partition key is so important. And now we're gonna do something practical with that partition key in this exercise.